roots are deeper than the bones of the others. My color will change with the sun. My branches were higher than anything on the hillside on the day that I watched them all come. Some were the color of the sky in the winter, some were as blue as the night. They came like a storm with the light of the morning, and they fell through the whole day and night. The colors flew high and they danced in the sky as I watched them come over the hill. To my wonder, sticks that made thunder, such a great number lay still. Light came again, there was death on the wind, as the buzzards made way for the worms. And the little white trees that don't bend in the breeze were the ones that will never return. The colors flew high and they danced in the sky as I watched them come over the hill. Sticks that made thunder, such a great number lay still. Those that have fallen come when I call them and answer the best that they can. But all they can see is what they used to be, and that's all they understand. The colors flew high and they danced in the sky as I watched them come over the hill. Then to my wonder, sticks that made thunder, such a great number lay still. The colors flew high and they danced in the sky as I watched them come over the hill. Then to my wonder, sticks that made thunder, such a great number lay still.
Okay, we don't know.
That's great. That's why it's called dark.
It's exactly.
Everyone knows all reputable information comes from random people on the internet. Tell me things, internet. The earth is flat. It's like school in your hand.
Dark matter is something we do not know what it is. We believe the dark matter is there, but we have never detected it.
Well, I'm afraid of course, it, there is no dark matter out there.
There was one?
There is no dark matter out there. We need to think really hard. To think really hard. To think really hard.
Let me ask you something. When you come in on Monday and you're not feeling real well, does anyone ever say to you, sounds like someone has a case of the Mondays?
No. No, man. Shit, no, man. I believe you get your ass kicked saying something like that, man.
Yeah, you're liable to get your ass kicked saying something like that around here, too. Although, Happy Monday. As happy as the Monday as you could have. Welcome to the IronWorX right here, freeworld.fm. Josh, Walt, Zack hanging out with you this morning. Gentlemen, how is your Monday going thus far?
Yeah,
man, I know it.
Yeah.
It's
a Monday.
And like, Zack showed up, but I've not actually.
You know, I don't know if he really did.
I'm here. Took me a minute to get up.
Well, welcome to the club.
Yeah. Seems to be the consensus this morning.
Indeed it do. Indeed it do.
How was the weekend, General? Titan happened?
Wait, what happened?
Anything?
Oh.
Titan happened.
No, nothing on my end.
I mean, exciting, I guess. I got out of the house and went somewhere with Shell and the sister-in-law, and we did a bit of getting away from our area. We went to Baton Rouge, which is an hour, I guess, from her house, 2 hours from our house. Went and checked out a few different little estate sales, and there's a whole thing that sister-in-law's into now. There's a movement or whatever you want to call it, an art group on Facebook that she's into, that she found, whatever, called Altered Moments, where they take the little precious moments, figurines, and alter them, turn them into new figures. And so she has done a couple of 3 or 4 now. And the first one she did, she took like a little, I'll find a picture to show you, but she took a little figure and turned it into a strawberry shortcake. And dude, like the little group there on Facebook, everybody went nuts. She sold it finally on eBay for like 170 or 180, something like that.
Damn.
So yeah, just a little clay, a little paint, a little time, and it looked really good. But yeah, that's basically what we were doing, is going to thrift stores looking for precious moments figures. So yeah, that was our Saturday.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, I'm gonna find what she did. She did some pretty good stuff. Give me a second. How was your weekend, Josh?
Well, mine was uneventful. I think I may have been a bit premature on Friday when I stated that Evie and Harris's bond was completely broken. I don't think it's completely broken, so that's good. They just only get along if they're on the bed with us. If we leave the room, it's no good. If they're somewhere else, it's no good. Seems like on the bed with us is about the only way they can really get along, and only then for... Well, I guess yesterday they were up there for about 10 hours or so. With at least one of us in there at all times. And they might have had a couple little scuffles, but we're going to try it again. We'll see how it works. See if we can't get them back to being. Because they're not.
Well, damn.
Yeah. I mean, it's like, I don't know. They'll snuggle, and it's like, oh, look, they're super cute. And then there's a big raging tornado of fur as they're going after each other. And you got to break it up and yell at them, and it's a whole fucking thing. How about you, Zack? How was your weekend?
Oh, not too bad. Got a lot of stuff done. Mowing and yard work and all that good fun.
I wish I could get my ass up to do that.
Yeah, I dread it. But I just say it's exercise, so I just shut up and do it. Yeah.
Yeah, I wish it were that easy for me. Well, it's just exercise. Just shut up and do it. Walking to California is just exercise, but I'm not going to shut up and just do it.
Yeah, but I got eventually.
Yeah, I know. Fuck it. We'll just let it all grow. Let nature take it back.
It was looking pretty natural back there.
Yeah, ours is looking pretty natural now, too.
Last mow, because this was the second mow of the year. The first one, I kind of didn't do the whole thing. Did about three quarters of it, and I left the bottom there by the river, kind of grow up and grow all the wildflowers. The wildflowers in the spring really are pretty. We get these yellow flower tops. I don't even know what they are. And then the salvia starts coming up here in a little bit. Not the good kind. There's lots of different kinds of salvia.
Not the divinorum. Not the kind you take to see God.
Right, right, right.
But yeah, that stuff grows all over down here in South Carolina. It's amazing.
Does it have medicinal properties, you know, different than the other type?
Yep. There's stuff that it does. People use it for all kinds of stuff.
I mean, I'm not asking for advice or anything. I just want to know for my own personal edification. Suckers. So, can y'all see my screen, Josh? Can they see my screen?
Not big. Give me half time.
Yeah, that's why I didn't switch yet, just because I know it was already a small picture she had up here.
You are set, sir.
All right, so this is her figure she had as it originally came from whatever little thrift store she picked it up. And this is what she turned it into. Pretty fucking nuts.
That is pretty fucking nuts.
Strawberry shortcake.
Oh, no, right. And like I said, when she put it, it got like 20,000 likes or some shit on her little page where she did it. And then she sold it for almost 180.
Dang, so, Michelle.
I know. No, this is her sister, Melanie. Michelle wants to do it, but she doubts her painting skills where I doubt my clay skills. So I told her, well, let's start getting in it as a team. You do the clay and I'll do the paint. So you never know. We might come up with one. She did another Mr. Rogers one, but I can't find it. She doesn't have it on her personal page yet, apparently.
Clays are pretty easy.
I don't know the name.
It was back in the
day. I didn't hear you, sir.
I said those are the pretty easy clay ones, right? Wasn't that just in a mold?
No, she did all that by hand.
Check out the first one, the original, and see the changes that she made. It's pretty crazy.
Oh, he didn't see the first one. I didn't know.
Well, maybe he did. I don't know if he maybe put the two together. That she just altered the first one with clay.
Here, this is it beforehand, Zach. And then this is what she turned it into with clay and paint.
Awesome.
Yeah, it's pretty crazy. She did a Mr. Rogers, and she just did, like, when we went over there Saturday, she had just done a Miss Piggy. And so on the hunt during the whole event, she found one that's apparently a music box that has a little figure sitting on a bench next to a piano. The piano is a music box. So we all three looked at each other and went, Elton John. So we'll see what she comes up with.
Elle is super artistic. I think she'd be great with clay. It's really... The trick is you just keep it wet enough while you're shaping it. As long as you keep it wet, it doesn't fold and crack and crease and all that crap. It's real easy to work with. And she's so artistic, dude. I bet she'd be great with clay. It's not like it's expensive to work with. It ain't like oil painting or anything like that where, you know, clay's pretty cheap. Saying she should give it a shot. I bet she'd be great at it.
Are you telling Michelle? Yeah, she's done a bit in the clay department back in the day. So it's me that hasn't really messed with it. I did some in college back, way back. It's when I first found, the FEMO, I think. Yeah, FEMO. We were at Lollapalooza and there was this crazy necklaces some guy was selling at his booth, and I was like, dude, how the fuck did you create these little faces, figures, crazy little mushrooms, just weird looking shit, real cool, trippy headed stuff. And it's like, FEMO, you go make it and bake it. I'm like, cool. So we found some at the art supply store and we began to play with it there at college. And I made a few little glow in the dark figures and things. It just wasn't my calling, so I didn't really mess with it at length. But yeah, Michelle did do a few things back, I guess, 3 years ago, 4 years ago. She goes through phases. She does different media. Like she'll go, like she did the quilling with the paper strips for about a year, and then she did the, I think the clay was after the quilling, right? Or did something? Oh no, the colored pencil and all that stuff with the coloring books, and then she started drawing her own. Damn it, what's it called? Where you do all the weird little black and white stuff, and it's all intricate. Zen doodle thing. Yeah, the Zen doodle thing. She did that for a while, and then she did the clay. I could probably find some of her stuff too. I'll dig around. But yeah, definitely, there's a lot of creativity around me quite often. Quite often. I need to find something like that again. Like I told her, if she wants to help me make one, I'll paint it if she'll do the clay. We just got to come up with one. And then to find them is not as easy here. I mean, I remember growing up, you know, grandma had them and probably aunt, whoever had them, and they were there and they weren't like anything I cared about. So it wasn't like, I'm like, who kept up with that? Who got it when she passed away? Where's that at? You know, I don't have a clue where all that disappeared to.
Remember that little boy and that little girl on their knees praying? Can I get that one?
Right, right. Yeah. Did try something I've never eaten before on that adventure. We stopped just trying to find like a burger place, some, you know, relatively simple. And they had what they called a pizza burger, which, you know, their homemade patty, their homemade marinara, some mozzarella, the good soft mozzarella, not hard, and the fried pepperoni on the burger. And that was it. I'm like, man, I don't know. I love pizza. I love burgers. I don't know if I want those stacked on top of each other. And while they were looking at the menu, I just kind of did the name of the place and the burger and a review of it just to see what other people said. And they came up with an article where the guy talked about the accidental creation of this burger at this restaurant and how he would promise to buy it back for or pay for it if you didn't like it and all this shit. I'm like, well, damn, I guess I'll try it. Needless to say, it was the best fucking hamburger I've had in years. I can't even explain how it worked so well that, yeah, it definitely was a surprise. So I had a dish I'd never had. That's pretty rare for me.
Thanks, Walter. Expanding your horizons.
You know, you got to sometimes.
2 weeks ago, I ate potato salad for the first time.
Really? Really?
Aren't you from Indiana? Get the fuck out of here.
Just something you didn't. I know, that's why I say that's something you just didn't want to try growing up, never got into it.
Yes, it just looked funky. I don't know. Maybe my aunt made a really crappy batch one time or something. I don't know. But I don't ever remember trying potato salad. I know. Crazy. It's good.
It depends on who makes it.
And there's so many
variations. Yep. I know, dude. I have a friend who makes it for us. When she cooks gumbo a lot, she'll make it. And she makes what she calls German potato salad with like olives in it. And it's like, probably good with that. I tried it. It's just not for me. Then Michelle makes this one that it's baked potato salad. And it has all the like bacon pieces, sour cream, cheese and stuff in it. And it literally tastes like a baked potato. But it's potato salad. And what else? I've had another weird one.
Stop, you're making me hungry.
I know, right? That's a go-to here in South Louisiana. You eat potato salad with your gumbo. A lot of people just take a big old ice cream scoop full of it and stick it right in the middle of their bowl and eat it that way. Other people keep it on the side and dip a spoonful of it as they dip their... Then they dip that same spoon filled with gumbo and stuff and take one bite of them together. It's a whole thing. Yeah, I'm getting hungry now too. Shit. Wait, what? On a plane saying apparently we've been playing Blackbird wrong. Oh man, now what have I done? I'm just playing catch up and chat. Good morning to you all.
Dude, every article that comes out about Tesla now is negative. Unless it comes from Teslarati website. like the cars, the, of course, the trucks. I saw like three different articles since last Friday, either about the Cybertruck getting stuck somewhere or this or that. Now they're shutting down production of the Cybertruck for the next week because of the pedal throttle getting stuck or something like that. Yeah, it's not looking good. Now they're saying the real-world Tesla Cybertruck towing range is in, and it's worse than we expected, despite all its new tech. Tesla Cybertruck towing a 4,000-pound camper only achieved 60 or 160 miles, less than half of its claimed range. Much older Model X camper achieved 235 miles, beating Cybertruck's performance despite older technology. It claims 340 miles of range and 11,000-pound towing capacity, and with 4,000 pounds, it did 160 miles. But it's still an impressive machine on paper, it says. Yeah, anything can look good on paper. That's a real nice piece of dog shit when it's explained to you on paper.
Wait, when he drew it in high school, it really looked cool on that notebook paper.
Yeah. High school, more like fifth grade. For real, that looks like the cars they used to show back in the 80s.
These right, the future, the retro future tech, right.
You can tell exactly how old Elon is, like right around the age. But then he promised, I guess the stock was dropping in Tesla, but then he promised to, I forget what it was, do some kind of driverless Uber type thing. He's promising to start working on that, so the stock went back up a little bit. Yeah, shifts at the Cybertruck factory will be shorter for a while. I don't know, you think people just don't like Elon Musk? Business Insider, Car Buzz. Three today. Three articles today on my very first like swipe through.
And they're all negative, huh?
All negative, yeah. Deliveries halted on the Cybertruck. Yeah, all of them. Full self-driving Teslas keep slamming into curbs. That's another article. Inside EVs. Yeah, either he pissed somebody off or they're just not making very good vehicles over there at Tesla. To be fair, I don't know how many people are making all that great of vehicles today. Anyway,
I was thinking about too. What if there was a car company that just went back to straight carbureted engines? Like old school muscle car V8 carbureted, room in the engine compartment to work type of fucking vehicles. Bare bones.
That's what I said.
Wouldn't that be nice?
That's what I said, man. So much the more simple, you know? And then it wouldn't have to worry about EMPs.
Well, your starters, your solenoids would still be affected, I think, even on the carbureted. But
yeah. But regardless, yeah, you're right. I would totally much prefer to go back to those engines.
I think it'd be a lot easier just to change a solenoid than it would be to replace the whole fucking car's computer. But what do I
know? Right, right.
There's a Kia and Hyundai are both saying they're making hydrogen powered vehicles for 2025.
I think that's a bit of marketing there.
Yeah, I don't see how you're going to get the fuel into the vehicle.
I don't think they're both making it. I think it's the same car maker. I think Hyundai makes them both.
Okay. The Hyundai Kia. Okay, yeah. They're claiming that they're making one. I know Kawasaki maybe it was Honda did something for a boat. I know they made a V8 boat engine that runs on hydrogen. But these are the first ones that will be tried in cars. I mean, it's a zero emissions, all that kind of stuff. It burns, you know, pretty much water. But you don't put water in the tank and then it runs. It needs like cold stored hydrogen, which is dangerous. So I don't know how they're gonna, how they do this. It's great in theory, but the infrastructure is definitely not there. I don't know. We'll see.
Logan just wants a car that would focus solely on reliability and longevity. Nice. No fancy stuff. Just make it go. Agreed, Logan.
Do a 55 Chevy.
I would even sacrifice reliability and or longevity for the ability to do my own repairs.
Just to cheaply. Go? Well, hell. Right. Absolutely.
Cheap parts, easy to replace. Just make it real fucking simple.
I can't even change the air filter on my car.
That might be user error, Trev.
come on, man. No, but seriously, I took it in to get my first oil change after I got the car from my grandmother. And I said, can you do the air filter at the same time? And then when I came back after it was all done, he's like, we couldn't even get to it. It would take us over an hour. You want us to do it? I'm like, nah, forget it.
Well, that's a crazy design. Usually air filters are, you know.
I know, right?
Pop, 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 and it's all good.
Yeah.
Yeah, these cars nowadays are ridiculous. You get a college degree to work on them. Yeah. Only a 33 Ford Coupe 3-window.
And I'm not sure a college degree would even help.
No.
I get the impression that all of those engineers that designed the fucking things probably had a college degree, and they didn't do so hot.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, you want to change your headlights? Just crank your wheel all the way to the left, and then crawl up under the wheel well, pull the fender guard out, and just start reaching, contorting your arm up around there to loosen those bolts. You'll be fine. What a fucking stupid idea is that? It's a headlight. Pull it out the front.
Isn't technology supposed to make stuff smaller? How did engines get so full?
Extra bullshit.
I mean, I used to be able to crawl in with my... I had a GMC Sierra 1500 truck. Big truck. Extended cab. Full bed. It was a farm truck. And I would pop that hood and I could... go and sit on the wheel well on the inside and prop my feet up there and work on that truck. No problem. That thing still had the distri-. Man, I got bit by that thing one time. Changing the plug wires. And right on the distributor cap, and I went to touch it while it was running. Smarts.
So that wheel well you were sitting on, it was fiberglass, right? And that all plastic engine right up there and that whole weight. I'm being facetious. Like that's the whole thing. Everything's smaller and crappier now. You can't even reach it. And when you do, you might break it if you pull too hard.
Don't want to sit on it. You don't want to, yeah, don't put too much.
And you definitely don't sit on it. Fucking A.
I've seen a couple different articles about this new DJI Avatar 2 drone. Everybody's saying it's awesome. It's this little teeny tiny thing. It's got a nice camera on the front, but it's supposed to be like super fast and real agile. And I don't think I've ever flown a drone yet. Besides,
pretty awesome. I've actually been looking at some Reaper ones lately, trying to decide if I'm going to. They make them. They don't make them. They do make them. Lower, duh. They make them and they refurb them. DJI does, and they have a whole like line or run or whatever of them refurbing. And a lot of people say they're great. So I would definitely have to get into it. There was a whole gap of just crap drones coming out for the cheaper consumer market that basically drove me away. That last one I got, Quentin, for that Christmas about 7 or 8 years ago was pretty much the last under $300 drone you could get that would do anything. What happened is they tried to make them seem like they were equivalent to the DJI with all the positioning and the hovering and all that. So they started including all these atmospheric based hovering systems that basically don't work worth a shit. Temperature changes mess them up, wind shift them bad. Yeah, they're not. All it did is make them harder to fly. So I just got out of it. It wasn't worth messing with. I bought two or three after that and I ended up returning them and just gave up. Some of the tiny ones that came along after that are really cool and got nice and upgraded. But unfortunately, with the aging eyes, it gets a little bit harder and harder to track that little inch thing zipping around 800 feet away, believe it or not.
So you're too old to fly a drone, is that what I understand?
Well, I'm too old to fly a fucking drone. Yes, that's true. You cannot see forever, try.
Just use the telescopic version of your eyes. Just zoom in, man.
Mm-hmm.
Can't you do that?
Go gadget magnifiers.
I'm an old analog version. I have to reach to the side of my eyes and roll the little wheel. That's hard to do when you're flying the drone. So.
Well, that's the break, gentlemen. We'll be back in just a few minutes. This is the IronWorX freeworld.fm. Also, YouTube IronRealm Media channel. Stick around. We'll be right back.
Oh God, I forgot about this.
one more thing.
I think I'm going to start cutting cars.
No, you shut the fuck up. Welcome back to the IronWorX. God, that was... You're not used to suicidal tendencies at 4:30 in the morning. I'll tell you that much.
Right? I wasn't ready for it, and I love that fucking song. Oh, my God. That was intense.
Walter, I found a gentleman last night. I think he's been playing for 20 years guitar. And he recorded himself when he was 9 and got his first guitar.
Nice.
And then he has like every year of his life going up, showing him progress. He was playing Mark Tremonti at like 15 or 16 years old.
I may have seen, who is it? Do you know the name offhand?
Find it right now for you. It was a 45 minute video, dude. And I sat and watched like.
Right.
I was just
one
like,
of the guys I'm into. That's one of the teachers I go watch on YouTube. Just recently put a video up like that. I wonder if that's who it is.
YS? Is
no,
his YouTube
that's not him. No, that's cool though. Send that link to me. Yeah, I'll check it out.
Hey, Walt, do you watch Michael Palmisano?
Oh, dude, Michael Palmisano is one of my favorite.
Yeah, he's
like,
good.
He's really, I like his vibe, I like what he's into, and yeah, his reactions are great. His teachings, like I watch his teaching videos, are great. Yeah, love it.
Yeah, this young man was just amazing, dude, watching him progress. And like, it was cool because he was real into the heavy stuff. Altered, he played a lot of Altered Bridge and stuff like that, learning while he was young. And I saw him do Tremonti, and you could tell that this young man is very proficient, you know, very technical and proficient and all that. And I think at the end, I think it's like his stuff. And you could see like near the end where he starts doing his own stuff, and it's not very intricate, but it's his, you know. And then a couple years later, it's his, and it's real intricate. Like he, you know, you add on to your songs. Just like any artist, you're never done, ever. I was thinking about that. You know, you'll hear some people in concert, and you want to hear your favorite song from off the first album, and they play it, and it doesn't sound the same. And you're like, oh, they must not be that good of artist. But no, they've changed that song so many times. You know, you play it, they played it in the studio, you know, however many times before they recorded that track, and now they've played it 1,000 times since then. So they've said, hey, let's tweak this here, let's tweak that there, let's do this here, let's slow the rhythm down a little bit throughout the whole song. Artists do stuff like that. You know, they're never done with their work, a true artist. They can only abandon them. I dropped in there. No, here you go, Walter.
Yeah, I got it. You did. You got it.
Okay, again for you. Uh-huh.
I have actually watched a few of his videos over the years. I just didn't know the name. His skill level is beyond me. Yeah, he's very fucking fast. Anybody that can do Avenged Sevenfold is a little further than I am. Trivium, yeah. I see like 3 or 4 of his videos though that have the red line under them that I've checked out like 2 years ago, a year and a half ago, that kind of thing. But yeah, go ahead.
Do you think that there's a music gene. You know, like, I know that there's laziness because I am lazy. But I think that if I had a music gene and I understood scales or arpeggios, or if I could even talk in music, like, you don't understand what I'm saying? Because music is a language and I don't understand the language. So I'm just curious, like, do you think that if I had put that many hours in 30 years ago, like, if you don't know how to understand music and scales, could you ever really learn? You know, sure. Could it be a part of you? Could you, like, it's like, you know, they say when you really understand.
But I think you could. I was saying it'd probably be harder. You know, learning as a child and taking in that information and holding it is a lot easier.
Right.
Sure, it could be done. Just takes a little bit more. Never too old.
Didn't he become avatars? Right. Sold his digital likeness to some company and retired.
Who?
The musical gene. Gene Simmons? Oh.
He did. Yeah, Gene Simmons, he did. You're right. Dude, no, you held on to that for like 5 minutes. I'm impressed.
I do believe there is a musical genie, though, of sorts. Not.
Yeah, her name is like, Mr. B Natural.
No, I'm talking about like these big bands that are starting to get promoted by big record labels. I believe someone comes to them and says, hey, you're going to sing this song on this album. You're going to play the music this way. You're going to sing it like this. And this song is going to go out on the radio. I don't doubt that one bit. Now, they might be told, hey, this song was written by so-and-so or so-and-so and so-and-so. But this is kind of like the whole Tavistock idea. You know, the songs that they want to be played on the radio, they want certain words to be said in certain phrases with a certain rhythm and a certain, you know. I don't know. It's weird. Under the Silver Lake. Remember that movie, Trav?
Oh, man. I watched it again last week.
The Man on the Hill.
Oh, my gosh. That movie is so wild.
Told him he wrote Bach in that.
Yeah. Yeah. That was a great scene.
Yeah. He's like, yeah, I wrote Smells Like Teen Spirit. I wrote this. I wrote that. I wrote like all these songs that I wrote, the songs that your grandparents were bopping to and that your parents were bopping to. And I write the songs kids are bopping to today.
Mephistopheles. I don't
doubt that at all.
Hey, what do you think that movie was freaking about anyway? Because it just starts off and it's weird. Like, what was that? Was that just, yeah, what was that? What do you think?
Now, what started off what?
Under the Silver Lake was just a fucking weird movie from the beginning. Like, there wasn't like this transition into weirdness where like he was normal and then he got hit in the head and then had this dream. And then that's what the rest of the movie was. The whole fucking movie was just weird.
Well, yeah, it was all about hearing that thing on the radio. And then it all got tied up with that girl, like a hidden message in an advertisement. Remember the old guy in the mountain said, yeah, you heard it. You got here, but that wasn't meant for you. You weren't supposed to get that message. So that was all about the billionaires. Like things on the radio you hear is like a message for some, you know, between the elites, yada, yada, yada. Yeah, it's crazy movie. Really, you could watch it 100 times.
Right.
And still get everything in the movie.
I might have to, because at the beginning, again, I know that I saw it, but I don't know that I caught, you know, that detail in terms of him hearing that message. So I'll have to go back and watch that again and see if I can pick that up again. But
So much. That movie is so, yeah. I wonder if there's got to be a book, you would think.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah. But yeah, just that whole idea that I believe that there are music genies out there, that these bands get handed things. Hey, this is what you're going to sing. And this is the music that goes with it. Do it. They say, yes, sir. Would you do that, Walter? To be famous and rich and melt a million faces up on stage?
Have pretty well lick your toes?
Man, I was going to say no till you brought up my damn toes, Travis. Thanks.
I love that line from Signs when that recruiter is talking to Merle, and he's like, you should be, you know, famous and making all kinds of money and having beautiful women lick your toes.
Yeah, that was a funny part in the movie. Like the way he says it and everything.
Yeah. Oh, that guy was creepy anyway.
Signs. Signs, signs everywhere, signs.
He probably wrote that one too.
I wonder if you could go through and guess which ones were written like that. Well, they say, I mean, I've never really delved too deeply into Tavistock. I know they had a lot to do with, you know, putting the bands together and this and that, and I'm sure they had to have had a lot to do with the words in the music.
Well, I mean, think about Stairway to Heaven, you know. How old are these guys? In their early, mid-20s?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, unless that generation was on a whole nother level of awareness, the stuff that they would bring up and talk about, I'm like, how the fuck do you guys know this stuff?
Well, wasn't Jimmy Page brought up in the occult? Like, he was one of those family members and one of those weird...
Talking about Jimmy Page?
Or Jimmy Page, yeah.
Yeah.
He was a student of somebody that was a student of Aleister Crowley, or he was a student of Aleister, something crazy like that.
Yeah, but even that's niche. Who does that?
These secret society family member
right.
type peoples. Yeah.
Right. Yeah, that's my going theory right now is that most, if not, well, I'll just say most of the celebrities and stars we see, they're just long family generations of elites.
Oh, yeah. Well, Hollywood will show you that right off. I mean, half the actors and actresses out there today are definitely a niece, nephew, son, or daughter of somebody that was in Hollywood before.
Yeah.
Well, you know, the idea of people writing things for other people. So I grew up hugely influenced and loved Stephen King's writing. And then he put out a book called Rose Matter that he didn't fucking write. 100% his wife wrote that book. But that's not anything you can find or see or find out the truth behind all that. Oh, he just tried a different style of writing. No, he didn't write that book. I read everything he wrote up to that point. He didn't write that book. He wrote the next book. And then the book after that, him and his wife wrote together. And then his son got involved and was part of the next book. So there's a thing, even when he and Peter Straub wrote a book together, they purposely tried to write in each other's style. But all of us true fans of Stephen King knew every time that happened in that book. I guess what I'm saying is there's this whole thing about something that comes out of you and the way it comes out of you and the way it's presented from you and from your true heart and your soul is one thing, but then something you've taken from someone else and give life to it and present it, and it just never rings true to me. Anyway, I mean, even the song like Prince wrote, but, you know, Nothing Compares to You. What was the one he wrote for Brick and the Bangles? You know, I mean, even... songs I didn't even care about, really.
Manic Monday.
I knew weren't written by those. Yeah, that was it. Yeah, there's something about a song from somebody else that just feels different. I don't know. Maybe I'm just hypersensitive to it.
It's funny you say that, dude. My mom,
go ahead.
She was ripping John Grisham yesterday in his newest book.
Right.
She's like, "This isn't John Grisham."
There you go. She knows.
And drawn out these first three chapters, and she's used to, you know, authors selling a chapter here and there or divvying it out to another author. A lot of writers do that, you know, the filler chapters and stuff like that, parts that they just need here. Here's what's going on in this story. Here's the names,
you know, it's this,
and yeah, but she said like the first three chapters, she couldn't believe it. We're not John Grisham.
Yeah. What's interesting that you mentioned that, I really like Robert B. Parker, and he wrote, a Western series, and he wrote a detective series based in Boston, Spencer, if you remember back in the 80s, Spencer for Hire. But he's a phenomenal writer, just fantastic. Just, but he died, and then other authors picked up the series of Spencer and kept writing. And they did a pretty good job. They got pretty close to where I was satisfied with, you know, this is a kind of a an homage to Robert B. Parker, because it doesn't really lose anything in the translation from one author to another. They did a pretty good job with anyone that they brought up, I thought.
Yeah, my mom says, you know, most of the time, I mean, she knows. She's been reading since she was, you know, like religiously, at least a couple books a week, unless they're real big, like her whole life. She's 75. So when, and she finds authors she likes, and she reads all their books, you know, sometimes multiple times through.
Well, give this recommendation to your mother. Her name is Louise Penny. Yeah, she writes a detective thriller series. It's really, really good. The first book is called Still Life.
Yeah, the last read book I read that was fiction, and well, allegedly, right? But it was Hannibal. I went through the whole series. Started with Red Dragon and then Silence of the Lambs. Or no.
Yeah.
You're right. It had Hannibal Rising, but that was written afterward.
That was later, yeah.
Child and why he's like the way he is, which was wild, dude. Just wild. Made me realize how bad war is, and not just for, you know, the people fighting the war, but the civilians that suffer from no food and, you know, no power, no wall, all that horrible stuff that happens when all that stuff goes down around you. But, yeah, no, the very last book, Hannibal, it was the worst ending to any. It made me stop reading fiction. She ended up marrying Hannibal Lecter. That's where the movie was actually better than. Yeah, she ends up marrying him.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, that's how it ends. I was like, what? So okay, I'm not even going to spoiler alert or anything like that. But
No, I've read it. I'm just fucking with you.
She watches him do, like, right at the end of the book. And then you turn around and marry this guy? Really?
Yeah. Did you read them as they came out? Like, were you involved? Like, all the controversy it caused? Everybody pissed as fuck? Yeah, it was.
Read all of them in a row. All three of the books in a row. Like.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, being readers like we were, Mom had found Red Dragon when it came out, basically. And, you know, passed it on to me. Here's a great book. Read it. So I did and loved it. And then, so we were ready when Silence of the Lambs hit as a book, and then that's about the time. And I had actually seen the Manhunter movie with Grissom. What's his name?
William Peterson.
William Peterson, yeah. He's in that, Manhunter. It is the first book. I mean, the first movie, Red Dragon. It the guy who played Hannibal in it was it Cox? Was that who it was? Damn, it's been a long time since I've seen it. Anyway, yeah. And then, yeah, when they finally put out Hannibal, yeah. Oh, God. So terrible. So much people bitching about it. And this is all, you know, pre-internet or pre-internet for us anyway. It was just a thing. People were not happy with that movie. Hey. Or that book. I mean, and the movie totally was nuts. Yeah.
I could not believe that that's how. And I had been reading a lot at that time. I was reading fantasy, I was reading crime novels and stuff like that, just whatever, science fiction, all kinds of stuff. I was really into reading. And that book, that was just the end. I was like, what? I think I said I'm going to take a break for a while. And I've just never gone back to it. And then Flat Earth happened, of course. My reading turned to research.
Fiction.
Yeah, other types of fiction.
Yeah, and that's a tough switch for me, too. When I'm trying, I usually have two or three books going at once. And so I'm reading, you know, something totally fictional over here, and it's great. I love it. And then next, you know, break or whatever, I'm like, hey, where's that other book? And I go into a whole different mindset, frame of reference, whatever. Research, I guess, mode. It's sometimes a little hard to switch that around.
Does Hannibal Ghost is my good movie?
Ha, yeah, that would be great.
What like was the that leopard
meet up, you said? Meet up with Jason.
Yeah, Hannibal goes to space. At least they didn't take
Hannibal versus Predator.
Yeah.
Right? I think they did that comic book, Dark Horse did. No, sorry. It's a comic joke. Everybody knows Dark Horse will cross Predators with anything. There was literally a Predators versus Archie comic. Literally.
Oh, old.
90s when Dark Horse hit. 90s was like, that was there. It may have been early 2000s. Let me go look. Hang on.
Do we have anything in the vault there, Josh?
I got a couple things. Why, what you got in mind?
I don't know. There is a song called Nothing As It Seems. It just kind of hit me. I don't know why. The idea of knowing a writer so well that you can just be like, hey, I know who this is just by reading something they wrote, not seeing the cover, you know, not seeing anything else, but just reading something that somebody wrote and saying, hey, I know who this is. I did that with this song, but it was with the guitar solo.
So you're not going to tell us who it is? You're going to let us try to guess?
You'll figure it out.
It's not hard.
Yeah, I expect you'll catch
up. Is it going to be like when I said, hey, these guys sound a lot like Aerosmith?
I was thinking about that, man.
I can only.
But yeah, I was driving to work and I hear this guitar solo going on. I was like, what song is this? Dude, that's Mike. I know that's Mike.
Ain't nobody
played. And it was the first time I heard a guitar solo and I knew the artist. I knew that guy plucking those strings before the singer started singing. It was a cool feeling.
So everybody,
they say when you know,
when you
sorry,
know,
Josh, what?
It's all right. When you know, you know. I was just going to say, and if you know while you're in chat, whilst during the break, go ahead and make your guesses. Like I said, I suspect it'll be pretty easy once I start. Or if you're listening after the fact, feel free to comment down below. This is the IRONWORX. Oh, you dirty, dirty bastard. God, I hate these fucking YouTube.
Dirty.
Wu-Tang Clan. Wu-Tang Clan.
All right. We'll try this again. Pot you up here. Yeah. Hey, we're still the IRONWORX, and we still will be back right after these messages. I think. Oh, holy hell. Remember how when I played it just 3 seconds ago and you could hear the commercial? Yeah, well, now it's fucking muted. Jesus. Fuck this video hosting platform.
Don't feel like methadone. Scratching voice all alone. There's nothing like your baritone. There's nothing as it seems. The little that he needs is home. The little that he sees.
Great, that's why it's called dark.
It's exactly.
Everyone knows all reputable information comes from random people on the internet.
Tell me things, internet.
The earth is flat.
It's like school in your head.
Dark matter is something we do not know what it is. We believe the dark matter is there, but we have never detected it.
Well, what I'm afraid of course, is that there is no dark matter out there.
So what one?
There is no dark matter out there, we need to
To think really hard.
We'll do it live! Fuck it! Do it live! I'll write it and we'll do it live! Right. Fucking thing sucks!
And welcome back to the first half of the second half of the IRONWORX. Right here, freeworld.fm. You can also find us on YouTube, but I recommend freeworld.fm just because it's got a much, much better chat. And it's, well, not YouTube.
It is not.
It's got that going for it.
So what was the mystery here? I'm sorry. I'm confused.
There wasn't a mystery. You talking about the song that just played?
Well, what was I guessing in chat? I thought I was not going to know this song or something.
Not everybody does, Walter.
I don't think that was Eddie Vedder. I could hear every word he said.
Yeah, that was a Marl. He sang differently on that one.
You're thinking of Scott Stapp. That's Eddie Vedder with marbles in his mouth.
Scott Stapp is?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Binaural album there. I'm the B-I-N-A-U-R-L. And it has it looks like an eyeball. It's a lot of pictures of space, right? The space imagery that NASA shows us. And they stuck an eyeball in the middle of one of them.
Well, I think
it looks like there's enough.
I think that was like the Cat's Eye Nebula or some shit. There was some NASA claims that was there originally, I thought. Looks like there might have been some alterations, but I'm pretty sure that's a NASA original.
Well, now, Josh, they have to take those ones and zeros and interpret them. Sure. Interpret them. So, come on now.
Uh-huh. Paint by number. I got you.
Yeah. You should see their Last Supper they did. It was great.
Oh, I pray for NASA's Last Supper.
A couple of kittens.
Rico has the alive guy.
Good morning, gentlemen.
Hello, Andrew.
What's going on, Andrew?
Well, I've got some good news.
What's up, Andy B? What's up, man? What's up?
Hey.
I'll be the judge of that.
Right.
Well, the good news is my interaction with two Glovers this past evening. And the first one was I actually had a cordial conversation with one of them. As long as you don't speak about the globe, I mean, some of them are like kind of cool people. And we were talking about electricity and computers for like 2 hours. So
I've had conversations with some of the slimiest of the slime trolls. That Gem Panda guy. Like,
I've heard about him.
He had first gotten into all this. I sat down and had a talk with him, and it was off the air and everything. And we were talking about, you know, living off the grid and this and that. And it was like a 10-minute beautiful conversation where his voice totally changed. It was a totally different person. And then all of a sudden, out of nowhere, like someone said something in his ear or something, he clicked over back to being Jim Panda the troll. And I was like, dude, Jeremy, that was pretty cool, man, having an actual conversation with you. You know, you're not bad in real life. And I was like, but I don't want to talk to you when you're being like this. We've never spoken again, but yeah, no, these are real normal. Nah, I don't want to say normal, but these are real with feelings, and they can be, you know, just good-hearted, normal people if you don't have them talking in that, like you said, about the globe.
Yeah, and then the other good news, actually, I have one more after this, is you know, I play chess like pretty much every single day. And Ruhif challenged me to a game of chess. And I beat the living shit out of him in like 16 moves. The game was over. And then he said, fuck you, Andrew. And then he left. I was like, well, hey, good game, I guess. I mean.
Now it's on. I want to see if I can last to 17 moves.
Maybe.
Do you play on chess.com?
Uh-huh.
I do, too.
I also play over the board, like competitions with the USCF. So I actually have like a national ranking.
Blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, no, blah, blah.
You haven't seen my opening.
But I'm going to share my screen real quick. If you guys don't mind.
No, not at all.
Cool.
And Trev, so, feel free to send me pictures of your opening in private message.
Yeah, right.
I will teach anyone how to play chess. It's fine. I'm actually going to be doing that on Discord for free pretty soon. So anyways, so this, I told you guys that Rico hooked me up with this guy named Nick who laser etchings, that kind of thing, with like glass. And I've been in contact with him quite a bit. And I don't know why he chose to do this one first, but that was just the first one on his list, even though I sent him all the other ones for IRONWORX and, you know, the one with the Cami. And he said he can do all of them, no problem. So the one he finally got done was this one. Whoa, what happened? Okay.
Nice.
So that was the one he chose to do first. I know it's not exactly like what Jaronism is.
A lot like little, it.
Yeah, this is not a finished product either. He said it's going to look a lot better once he puts like acrylic over it or something like that. I don't really understand what it's going to make look better, but yeah, that is a sample piece that he did on a small little piece. And he said it's going to look the exact same thing, but it's going to be bigger. 11 by 13 inches, I believe. So nice. I'm going to be sending those over to you guys as soon as he gets around to doing them. Because it takes a little while to do them. I'm surprised he doesn't charge more. But anyways, yeah. That's just a little bit of a tidbit. I mean, it's pretty fucking awesome when you look at it. That's
Oh, glass. Yeah, it's fucking cool as hell.
And laser, so.
It's very cool.
So, yeah. As soon as he gets around to it, I'm just going to need a place to send it to you. That's all. And anybody else that's going to potentially earn one is going to earn one. And I think all three of you have earned one.
Too kind, sir.
Thank you, man. You are.
Way too
kind. Absolutely.
But yeah, anyways, that was just
something. I won't be showing you my opening, though, Andrew. I'm just saying.
Say what?
To earn it, he's not going to just show you his opening. He's not that kind of guy. I mean, you take him to dinner, sweet talk him a little, then he might show it to you. And once you see it, by God, you'll
sweet nothings.
It'll definitely.
I would have played chess with you eventually, Andrew. But yeah, after I heard 16 moves, I don't know. I'm gonna see what Travis does first, and
I thought that's what you were talking about, because in chess, there's the opening. That's like the first several sequential moves that are used to develop your pieces. And
what were you thinking about, Andrew?
Get your mind out of the gutter, freak.
Ow.
No, my basic opening is the fianchetto.
It works. Just it's like, very basic.
It works.
I mean, yeah. Hey, I mean, Larson did it.
See, my opening, I just take my king and I knock your king over. You've never seen a move like that before.
What's really crazy is that there's some people, I still don't know how they do it. They're chess players, and they're also like savants on top of that, where it's called blind chess, and where they're able to actually, they're allowed to sit in front of a chessboard, a blank chessboard.
Yeah, and then they just see numbers.
Yeah, well, then they're going to be playing against maybe 15 to 30 people, as an example, or more. And simultaneously.
Yeah, that's just crazy.
And they have to remember the positions of every single piece on every single board. And every single board is going to move at a different rate.
It shows you how the human brain can work if you train it that way.
Andrew, I think if you can remember this, but I can't remember where I saw this or not, or if it was in a movie and it was just fictitious or if it was real, but I think there was a, you know, like a grandmaster style, like a young person who then went up against a number of other grandmasters at the same time. And what he ended up doing was just making every move that the previous guy moved for the next guy. So he just used all of their moves against each other. You understand what I mean? The opponent's opening move, he used on the next guy. And then that guy's opening move, he used on the next guy. So he was just using his opponent's moves. And then he ended up, I think, winning all, you know, he defeated them all. But he just used their moves against each other.
That makes sense. Yeah, it does. I don't know who that was, but there have been a lot of people. Capablanca, Fischer, Carlson, all these different people throughout history have done it's simultaneous chess, and where I don't know what the strategy is with that, but I think most of them are not necessarily doing that because it wouldn't work out very well because of the move variables just in the first move of chess at all, like white moves and then black moves. There's 400 different possibilities just in the first outcome of the game. And then by turn, I think it's turn 5 or 6, something like that, there's like 30 billion different outcomes. So when it comes to like chess, like computers, they still can't master it. But when it comes to doing simo-chess, there's certain strategy you could use. But, sorry, I'm not trying to make this a chess conversation. I know a lot of people are just like, it's boring.
Well, that's cool. It's very cool. In fact, Logan Cook there in chat wants to see an Andrew versus Trav live stream chess match.
No. I'll play anybody anytime.
I'm not saying we would wager on it. That would be illegal. But, you know, as a way to raise some money one time.
No, I'm just, I enjoy playing. I'm not anything to lay bets on.
No, it's fine.
Mr. 1-to-1 says that was Darren Brown who's done that on YouTube.
Okay.
Playing multiple games and memorizing all the boards.
Darren Brown. I don't know who that is.
Oh, yeah. He sure fucking did. Oh, yeah. You need to go dig into his
mind catalog. Tricks, manipulation, hypnotics, but...
The thing was, he didn't really know how to play chess.
Okay, magician. Oh my goodness! Nah,
he's not a magician. No, he's a whole different thing he does. Yeah, way beyond magician. He's an observant person who pays attention to every fucking thing that goes on around him.
Who's this guy?
The one in the mall. Darren Brown is his name.
Darren Brown.
In the mall.
He'll walk up and he'll walk up and buy shit with a blank piece of paper and shit with people, dude. He's fucking it's scary the shit he can do.
And he'll even tell you it doesn't work on everybody, but it works on most people. It's like, you know, like the Jedi mind tricks. There's certain people it doesn't work on. Well, that's how this is. But yeah, he'll go up with a blank piece of paper and buy like a $500 bracelet or something and walk.
Oh, fuck. I want to be a Jedi. All right, hold on.
Darren is spelled with two.
And when he played
those
chess. Yeah, D E R. When he played those chess people, he didn't know how to play chess, I believe, or he didn't know it at a professional level or whatever. He was actually using everybody else's opening move against everybody else and just kept doing that.
Yeah, he's a pretty interesting guy. Pretty cool stuff that he shows. So
English entertainer and mentalist.
Mentalist, that's what it is. Like, he had all these, I don't know how real this was, you know, it was, he is kind of like TV based. It's really high. It's not like a YouTube video. It's like really well done. But there's all these people walking around in a mall, right? Just a regular old mall. And there's music playing in the background, and he inserts this set of audio of him speaking. And it's just saying for everybody to raise their hand when he tells them to. And all of a sudden, in that little audio thing, he tells everybody to raise their hand. And like 70% of the people just stop and put their hand up in the air for no reason whatsoever. Now, I don't know if that's real, but if you can do that without the person actually knowing why or this or that, that man, we are very programmable. Maybe not everybody is, but it's scary.
That's television, though, isn't it? That's movies. That's programming in general. You get 80% of the population, and you get the other 10% screaming, "You motherfuckers are being programmed. What the fuck is wrong with you?"
And yeah.
10% of the people are just quiet because they're like, fuck, don't like step things up. Don't focus your attention to try to program me. I'm just going to be quiet, keep my head down, maybe pretend to be programmed.
It is remarkably easy to actually trick people. I mean, I can show you a card trick right now that I've been working on for a little while. I'm pretty sure I got it perfected by now. And, like, I can even tell you how it's done, and you still wouldn't understand how it's done.
Is it original, or are you...
Huh?
Is it original?
Sort of.
Did you make this? Oh, yeah? Nice.
I mean, all card tricks are... and magic tricks are derived from some other form of magic trick. I mean, there's very few, if any, that are original nowadays.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah, I get that. I was just wondering if you are, you know, were the one who orchestrated the...
I know the methods and techniques to do them, so I can actually use the deck of cards to my advantage, and also deception. That's essentially what it is. And you would have no idea what I'm doing.
You ever seen Chris Ramsey?
Yeah. Yep.
Yeah, I love Chris. He's great, man.
I've watched.
We watch his puzzle videos. He buys those really hard level 10 puzzles, or people send them to him, and he'll sit there for hours and hours and hours, and it's neat watching him figuring stuff out.
Those are like the first one I saw was him doing. There was something like there was like a ring inside of a bottle that was attached to like a screw or something like that, and he had to like undo it. It's like, how? And he shows you how to do it. And he's a super cool dude. I think, he's a pretty good magician. He's not perfect, but he's more into puzzles than he is to magic, but he's also a professional magician and makes a very good income from doing that.
I love the guy he showcases all the time, the one with the cigarette, where he tries putting a cigarette in his mouth, and it keeps turning around.
Mario Lopez.
Oh, man, Mario Lopez is... If you've never seen an illusionist or a magician, like a really, really good one, go watch Mario Lopez.
Yeah, no one knows how he did that trick. Like, how do you continue to turn a cigarette around in your mouth live on camera over and over and over?
Turn it one way to the other.
Like, yeah, it's like it doesn't even make sense how he can even do that. But no, it's not demon magic or anything like that. It's just that's what a lot of people relate magic to. But I recommend everyone to study magic to a certain extent. Now, whether you get good at it or not, just understand the basics, because it's used. Good.
I was just going to say, it lets you know what's possible, you know, how you can be being deceived, and that you need to keep, you know, your wits about you and always use logic and don't allow people to deceive you so easily, because it can be easily done.
Learn the misdirection.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, misdirection, sleight of hand, and don't look in this hand, don't look in that hand, and then that kind of thing, and which is misdirection. Sleight of hand. And once you understand how that works, just basic magic tricks, then you'll start to look at the world a little bit differently in regards to politics, NASA, Flat Earth, all those different kinds of things. Because it does show you that what the government is essentially doing, and the media especially, is they're using magic tricks, but they're doing it to the public on a mass scale. And people don't want to accept the fact that they're being tricked. Therefore, they get tricked. It's kind of... It's fucked up to say it, but it's true. And that's what I did for, like, 3 solid months when I had hand surgery. And after that, I was like, whoa. I mean, I was already a flat earther at the time, but that was a whole different thing for me. Like, understanding the mental manipulation that people can do to other people. I mean, I can do one right now for you, and I can even tell you how it's done, and you still wouldn't understand it. And I will. I'll tell you what. Maybe after the stream's over, I'll show you guys.
I've been thinking about Stockholm Syndrome lately. And how you think some of that, the not allowing the idea of flat earth in and just, you know, totally believing the overlords, do you think some of that could be cases of Stockholm Syndrome with these people?
Yeah, well, isn't there another term for it? It's not Stockholm Syndrome per se, but it's sort of like being in an abusive relationship, and they're too afraid to, like a woman that's getting beat by her husband, and she's too afraid to divorce him because of, you know, she's afraid. Rather than Stockholm Syndrome is when you're agreeing with your captor at a certain point. You start like, oh yeah, now I get why I'm a slave. I get it. That's cool. Versus being in that situation and being forced into it because out of fear.
What are you looking for? Helsinki Syndrome, is that the other one?
I don't know. I
think that's the other one. I know Munchausen is keeping them thinking they're...
Or yourself. Yeah. I think Munchausen by proxy is someone else.
Right. Yeah, Munchausen. My grandmother had Munchausen syndrome, and it doesn't necessarily have to be, well, Munchausen by proxy. I don't know about that one, but my mom is the first one that told me, oh, yeah, your grandmother has Munchausen syndrome. I was like, what? Like, what is that? She's like, oh, because, you know, she was starting to get a little bit lonely in her, you know, later days of her life, and she was a retired nurse, so she would constantly be going into the hospital, like ambulance rides and things like that. And she didn't have any serious medical condition. She was just there because she was looking for attention, which also happens to mothers, apparently, that are trying to get attention when they will intentionally get their children sick.
That's the by proxy.
Oh, that's the by proxy. Okay. Oof. That's twisted.
There you go. Yeah.
It is.
Anyways.
Well, we're going to take a little break.
Yep.
Is this the last break? Good Lord. It is.
It certainly is. Where am I? Here I am. All right. Yeah. We may extend this one a touch. I'm not sure yet. I'm going to go out to the kitchen and see how it all shakes out. But you all stick around, because we still have another 30 minutes left of the IronWorX right here on freeworld.fm, or you can still find us on YouTube. Shout out to everybody there on the YouTubes. Wasted away, trapped in their maze. Gotta get out, set by people to have about. Go!
Triple beam. One side is crazy fat, the other's pissing mean. Half of me's got problems, the other lives a dream. Well, I'm bipolar, I'm confused. Split personality, I don't know which to choose. One side is filthy rich, the other is so poor. Count me out a thousand times, I still come back for more. You're doing just what you can, but already you're done. Get your ass up off the couch and roll another for fun. Cause I ain't even begun, barely dead in my stash. Open your eyes and grab a pop, or else it's time for you to dance. We're gonna go when it's time to dance. Grab your sack, don't get your cash. Life too fast, cause who's your plan? Live, I live, cause I might be a mess. Watch your back, it might be over. Sometimes I feel bipolar. Get confused, I know where to go, so stop. You're slow to tempo. Intimidating, smoking people like you. Wasting my minutes like a cell phone that you merely abuse. First I question, then those unpaid dues. Confuse me, not no second guess. Session veterans never lose. like me to look confused. Walking a mic with your fake dudes. Fight some bitch, we win and lose. How many people don't got a clue? Don't got a clue, better figure it out. Pop that pencil, put it in your mouth. Yo, don't need the doggies. Me and my honky smoke that songy.
You're done, go to bed, pipe it, bye.
Realize your life's alive and not a fairy tale dream. Most comfortable with slow flow shows how I like my things. And never pass a pack bowl unless you know there's some green. Like, whoa, whoa, rip it to the flow. I'm feeling faded, give me some more. Drink that beer and roll the spliff. I do what I do, you can suck my dick. If you don't like it, I don't give a fuck. I just took shit and I just threw up. Blow that button out my throat, I choke. And slow the tempo.
Just put it out of the park. Another win for home teams. Put the bite with a bark. Cross a light with a dark. Another dart at the mark. You never get your bowl burning if you don't got the spark.
Take back up, you might get by. Slow your roll, put your shoes on tight. Won't smoke, you might get done.
Nothing, no one. Tell me what. It's full of luck.
How many people live to run?
Got nothing.
With a big fat blunt.
You're done.
You're done.
Seem to fade. Oh, no. One.
slammed all the laws. Jeff calls my name and it seems I've been buried alive.
Like somebody's got a case of the Mondays.
It's never too early to learn that the government is a greedy piglet that suckles on a taxpayer's teat until they have sore chapped nipples.
And welcome back to the fourth and final segment of the IronWorX right here, freeworld.fm. Josh, Walt, Zack hanging out with Andrew and Travis this morning. That was a little bit of the Cottonmouth Kings there for the first song. It is a little frantic, a little hectic at times. The song is bipolar, so that's the idea.
Yeah, that was a wild one, man.
Little hip-hop music, little punk rock, and then they switch back and forth between the two. Do what?
It kind of reminded me of a young Sublime.
Yeah, I could absolutely see that. And then they came out of probably not terribly far from the same area.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, Sublime was Long Beach, I guess. That's not terribly far at all.
Yeah, then the other song you played was honestly one of my favorite bands, Avenged Sevenfold, and they were a little too whiny and high-pitched when they were first starting, but after he got over that, they started doing a little more...
Interesting, Andrew. That was why I initially didn't like, as much as the guitar wailed and everything, it was the poor, pitiful me shit I was so tired of in music at that point in time. Everybody, every band came out, you know, Stained and fucking everybody, oh, I'm so sad. Rock, 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 jam, guitar solo. Oh, I'm so pitiful. Rock, 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 jam, solo. You know, it just got to be very formulaic.
Yeah, you guys are going to curse me and probably never talk to me again after I say this, but
God damn you.
one of the bands I cannot stand, not a single song, is Led Zeppelin.
I'm there with you.
Right behind you, friend. There's three songs that I will sit and listen to. Yeah, I've always been that way. I never did get it ever. Growing up, I was there in the era of it and didn't get it. I was like, not for me. The only songs I like are way recent, like in the last 10 years of my life.
I've got a really close friend.
From top to bottom, the vocals, the guitar player, whatever. Just never got Bonham was about the best part to me.
And you got to give Bonham some props on the drums.
I did. Oh, yeah. So I said he was the best thing in that whole band. Absolutely, he was. He did some fucking different shit. But the rest of it, I just never did jump on. I never got my lead out.
Did you hear about the Guess Who?
What? Bert
Cummings. He was one of the original co-founders. The Guess Who is on tour right now, right? And not one original member is in the current tour.
It's great. Well, I was in the third iteration. I should count.
Oh, he is flipping out. What did he do? He made it so nobody can perform any songs that he wrote, co-wrote, or published. It's kind of like what's his name from Pink Floyd.
Wait, who's he now? What are you talking about?
This is the Guess Who.
Yeah, but you said he.
Yeah, Burton Cummings.
Oh, Burton Cummings. American Woman.
Okay. These Eyes. Yeah, he made it so he's losing all of his royalties from songs used in commercials, on the radio, and wherever else. He said he will do whatever it takes to stop the fake band. This is what he told the Rolling Stones. They're not the people who made these records, and they shouldn't act like they did.
Yeah, that would be I would be hard pressed, in my opinion, like if Van Halen started touring and there's not one fucking original, like I wouldn't go watch that show per se. Unless, you know, like I wouldn't watch a Journey cover show. It was called Escape, I think was the name they chose, or they chose one of the album titles for their group name. And I liked it, but I mean, the guy looked and sounded just like Steve Perry. So, I mean, that's what I went to go see, you know what I mean? So I was happy with that. But I knew ahead of time that nobody was, you know, it was a cover band.
Yeah. Yeah, that's wild. Not one original member.
And you know who else that's in the chat who's been here before? Is also a very popular musician and knows some very high up there musicians is Rico.
You talking about name dropper?
Oh, come on. Yeah, Rico.
I love Rico.
Yeah, he knows some pretty popular people.
I wish I could have hung out with Rico back in the day. That would have been epic. What? I mean, I'd like to hang out with him today, but that would have been even epicer. Epicer?
Yeah, epic-er. Go with it, man.
Carriot. I think we broke people in chat with the Led Zeppelin. I've said it before. I've never been shy about. No, I've said that before on this show. That never got it, never did really understand it, never. So, but apparently, all of us agreeing must have broken people. I see a few what the fucks in chat.
I don't like men that sing like they're women. And that's what I always found.
That has no. That has nothing to do with it.
I'm not worried about that.
That has nothing to do with it. For me, it's just something about the vibe of it. I guess I was picking up on the Jimmy Page dabbling in dark arts. I don't know. I just never vibed with me. Just never did. Still doesn't.
Yeah, there's certain bands that become very, very popular. Like Aerosmith. Fucking can't stand them.
Toys in the Attic is like in one of my probably top 20 albums. I wouldn't say top 10, but top 20 albums. Toys in the Attic by them. And that's about it. I appreciated a few of their songs later on. But yeah, again, I've never been a big radio dude, though. I always listened to what I wanted to. Radio was strictly something I had to endure on car rides. Oh, yeah, dude. Now, well, that's what I grew up with, radio that had deep cuts, radio that played anything, not just what was the current hit, but they would play like.
Who deep made cuts, the song?
That's what it was.
Radio Killed the, what's it called?
The Buggles.
It's a band called Thank you.
The Buggles?
Yeah, it was a super group.
What is that? A super group? Like tons of musicians?
Well, no, not tons of musicians, but it was made up of, it was cobbled together, and I can't remember which ones were which, but from Yes, all of these prog rock bands. You can probably tell us, Walt. Wasn't the Buggles made up of all of these individuals from prog rock guys?
He could tell you. He's just not gonna.
I know. I couldn't. I was looking for my damn mute button. I do that often. I'll drop it to the bottom and can't think. It's floating on one of my pages, so I keep forgetting that once this is at the bottom, it's not on a different page. Anyway, so wasn't it Trevor? No, that's not who that was. That was another supergroup that Trevor
Raven was. Look it up.
Trevor Horn. I just looked it up. That was it. Yeah. But as far as, I don't know of them being a super group per se. In fact, I thought it was based around that one dude and kind of they created a band for this video, maybe. Let me see. They were in Yes after that, is what I'm seeing now. After that song became a hit, they joined Yes. That's what happened. Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
I thought it was before. Okay.
Mm-hmm. I just read it, so that's what happened.
Yeah, I think I overstated it by saying supergroup.
Oh, that's cool.
Well, why'd you
now, GTR? GTR, remember them?
GTR? Or you GTR. Talking about Grand Funk Railroad?
No, I'm talking about GTR.
I don't know what that is.
They were a prog supergroup. They came out around 84, 85. It was like...
Really?
It was, it was Steve Howe from Yes in Asia and Steve Hackett from Genesis. And that's why they called it GTR, guitar. And then, the vocalist was like... who was he from? I can't remember now. Dude, one of the best like underground prog albums that no one knows about. When the Heart Ruled the Mind is one of my favorite. That is a top 10 song. Top five song.
I've heard that. I think I've heard that.
Yeah, that's GTR. When the Heart Rules the Mind, that's GTR. Yeah.
Huh. Man, that's crazy. Like, wasn't Asia? Yeah, Asia was a super group too, wasn't it?
They were. Yep.
Yeah. Oh, that's wild.
Shout out to Billingtono. Congratulations on your job. You kick ass on your first day of work. I hope the Avenged Sevenfold played whilst you were listening and you were able to hear it and it was able to pump you up and get you ready to go and get you out the door. Much love. We'll be thinking about you.
Oh, he's got a new job? Right on. Show up 30 minutes early and stay 30 minutes late. That's a good way to start your first week.
That's always the start. Right. Yep.
He's there. It's on time. Going well so far, he says. Good deal.
Right on.
Do we know what it is? What is he doing?
Porn, I think, is what he's doing. I'm just kidding. I have no idea.
But he's going behind the camera this time.
Porn soundtrack. Right, porn soundtrack. He's got that wah pedal. I saw it on his book.
For all the brown cows and the brown chickens or whatever.
Okay, whoa, okay.
Brown chicken, brown cow. Come on, Andrew. What the fuck? It's 2024. You've never heard that.
Yep. 10 minutes. Flew by.
Yeah, it did. Although, Buried Alive was nearly 7 minutes long.
I didn't get to catch all of it yesterday on Globusters, but Jaron was showing that new trailer for the... What's the name of the movie that's coming out this summer? In July? Like, the Moon movie?
Oh, I forget.
No.
Was it on Globusters? Or, I think it was on
Globusters. Fly Me to the Moon.
Yeah.
It's the one about faking the space, or faking the moon landing.
About how they really went, but they also faked it, too, just to make sure, because they had to beat the Russians, yada, yada, yada. But I bet in the end that they do make it. most likely.
That was always my excuse in high school, because I had seen the proof, you know, for the first one, and basically, yeah, it don't look real anymore to me, but they had to fake it to get there. So everything after that was real. You know, that was kind of how I played that one off.
They can't show us the real stuff for national security. That's why they always show us that. The cartoon of the
pyramids and temples and all kinds of stuff they found up there. A civilization that once lived on the moon and they didn't want anybody to know about it. So they go get all the tech.
Right.
Yeah, there's all kinds of stories.
Too many right angles. Nobody has. Nature doesn't make right angles like that. That's got to be a fucking structure on the moon. Moon base!
Bismuth makes no right angles whatsoever.
None.
Yeah, I love it. NASA.
Yeah, and don't forget, too, that they also put out that movie, which I refused to watch, A Three Body Problem.
I made it about.
And it's really starting to not work for me. Oh, you didn't go. What happened? What happened, Travis?
Oh, no, I just made it through two episodes and I was done. I'm just like, yeah.
See, I've already got that feeling on the first one. Yeah, it's a series. Yeah.
It gets better. Yeah. I feel like it does get better. There's a lot of messages to it. I finished it a while back. There's several messages. I think there's a few poignant phrases and things that went on in there. I mean, there is, of course, it's a whole... There's a lot of sound bites in that first couple episodes that you could just pull out that would be hilarious for the show. I'll give you that much. About science being broken, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera.
Right.
But it does, there's a whole... I mean, it's fantasy. Okay. I mean, even if it's a globe Earth fantasy and there's a lot of crazy stuff, but it's a fucking story. And...
Yeah, but what do you think about the subtext per se of the augmented reality? What about that? You know, of going into a simulation and being fully aware, you know, like going into a dream and lucid dreaming. You know, I find that interesting, an aspect of it's almost like a subtext that they aren't really paying attention to, and they're, you know, misdirecting you with the three body problem, and they're not really, you know, delving into what they can fucking do with the brain and the mind. You know what I mean? Like, that part was more intriguing to me than the three body problem.
Yeah, there was definitely a lot of potential there that I think would have been a much more entertaining show than the one that they actually did make. And I'm trying to talk about it and not give away any spoilers for those that may want to go back and finish it or watch it at all.
Well, I was after you said go check it out. So, again.
Hey, Walt, let's do a watch party. I'll watch it with you, man.
That'll work.
All right. How about this one? I've never seen it. I have no intentions of ever watching it. 2001 A Space Odyssey.
Oh, you need to watch that, dude. You need to watch it.
There's a whole lot more going on there than just what you think.
Man, listen.
But you really should read the book.
Hold on, dude. Yeah. First of all, the book was read by Dick Hill, and he's one of my favorite audiobook readers. But the movie, Andrew, is just a cinematic. It's just a fucking masterpiece. And just sit back, get stoned, and get your mind blown.
I'll consider it if I can get stoned at least.
I even enjoyed 2010, personally. That was me. A lot of people didn't, but I did.
Yeah, I enjoyed it. I enjoyed it as well, but I didn't as much. I thought the first one was superior.
Wait, wasn't that one of the trivia questions?
It was a little long-winded when I saw it. I guess for me, it was a little like establishing way too many shots. You know, it was the 60s. So I got it. It was, oh, look, Jack's dreaming. The film is tedious. It is a little... Yeah, if I had not read the novel and knew what was kind of already going on, the movie would have bored me to the point I probably would never have finished it to see how they pulled off things I knew were coming in the book, you know? So it was definitely a an early cinema that, you know, used to have a long, winding, establishing shots and timing, and there was a lot of, it wasn't quick cuts and all that. That's not what I'm looking for either. I'm just saying it definitely had a lot of long shots and establishing, no dialogue. Yeah, if you didn't know what was going on, it could be very confusing.
And if you watch,
so have you,
if you watch it in the widescreen, real quick, if you can watch that movie in widescreen, I highly recommend it. And maybe if you even get a wild hair up your ass, watch it a second time, but on your cell phone, and then dig into some of the breakdowns of the monolith and things like that. But never mind. Anything by Stanley Kubrick, if you are a fan of film at all, anything that's directed by Stanley Kubrick, I think needs to be watched and rewatched and rewatched and rewatched.
Oh yeah.
To include,
I haven't seen it, but I came across this like black and white from like the '50s. Was it like the '50s he made this movie back in the, like one of his early, and it didn't look like anything like he would have made. It was, you know, black and white. It didn't look sci-fi or anything. That's like, you know, so it was, you guys familiar with that at all? Like one of his earliest films?
Yeah. It's got one of those iconic pictures of, I think they even used it in, was it Con Air? No. One of them stupid ass movies. I think it was like the guy riding the nuclear bomb, like a horse.
Oh, no. That's not what I'm talking about.
No, that's
am I wrong?
Yeah, that's late.
Yeah, I'm talking earlier than that even. I'll have to look it up.
Yeah, Strange Love was like 65, 68, something like that. No.
2001 was 68. 68. Yeah.
Yeah.
Dr. Strange.
So Strange Love would have probably been around 65 or so. Let me go look. Hang on.
And we're talking before 65.
1964, Dr. Strange Love. There we go. So was it Fear and Desire, Killer's Kiss, The Killing, Paths of Glory, or Spartacus? Would have been pretty much what he did before Strange Love.
He did Spartacus?
Okay. I got like 10 more things to talk about, but it's like pretty much that time.
Damn it.
Love y'all.
Kirk Douglas. Sorry, I was doing my chant. Anyway, yeah.
Thanks, guys, for hanging out with us this morning. We'll be back here Wednesday morning and again on Friday morning for more of the IronWorX right here on Free World.
Love y'all.
Love you guys. Enjoy the rest of your week. Be good. Be well. Do good and do it well.